Welcome to Rejoice Online, and thank you for joining us wherever you may be this day. We believe that all are welcome without exception at God's table. God loves you. Let us respond to God's grace and love in song.
Let us pray. Lord, may we follow your ways. May we continue to keep your statutes and your ordinances and your commands. May we continue to follow you. Oh, that you would grant us the grace to be able to do your will in this world. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, I know there is a distance between the way the world of the Bible thinks about things and the way that we often think about things, and some of that has to do with what we think about our thoughts, our emotions, our will. And so, for example, in when we talk about the heart, we're often thinking about the seat of emotion, the seat of desire, passion, anger, all these emotions. We think that they rest there. But in the ancient world, when they talk about the heart, they're not talking about emotion. Emotion in the ancient world comes from the gut. The heart is the seat of will, of decision, of drive, of faithfulness. And when we talk about the, having our heart in the right place, it's about having the will to do that which we know God is calling us to do. And yet I think sometimes our heart loses its way. Sometimes our heart or our will commits itself to the wrong things, or it begins to just go through the motions. And that, I think, is where we need God to come and heal our hearts so that we may be able to follow anew. So a couple digressions. So I have a friend of mine who was my first roommate when I was in college. His son is now entering the band and the choir at Texas A&M. And so he's been posting all these pictures of his son, getting his head shaved, being issued his uniforms, all those type of things that go into that. And in that time and that space, you lose a lot of your distinctiveness. You don't get to dress like you want to dress. You dress like everybody else is dressed. You don't get to style your hair however it's going to work for you. It's all of a sudden you have one hairstyle and so does everybody else. And within the Corps of Cadets, at least, you lose your first name. You lose your privilege, your right to be able to express your emotions during that first year, especially. And there are a lot of things to where you are told, here is the role that you have to play. Here is the thing that you are supposed to do. And one of the most helpful things I ever learned in that first 2 years I was in the Corps of Cadets was to be able to say, you know what, ultimately, this is a game I need to learn how to play. This is a part I need to learn how to act. And otherwise, for me, it was going to be too much. It was giving up too much of myself. It was giving up too much of who I was. And I know I'm not the most emotive person, but even I, when I'm told you can't express that anger or that sadness or that hurt, even I can't do that. So kind of another digression. So one of the, I'm not a person who watches a lot of TV. And I have people come up to me all the time, have you seen this show? And 99% of the time, the answer is no, because again, I just don't watch that much TV. But one of the shows that I did get hooked on until it was canceled was a show that was, again, it was a short little show, but it was a, it was called Face Off. So it was this show where you had people who were, they were makeup artists and they were costume designers, and they would come together, and it was this kind of this creative competition every week where they had to get people ready to play a role in a movie or a film or something like that. Now, these characters never went into the movie, but it was the showing the process of how you transform a person from looking like they look to looking like a fantasy or horror or a piece of artwork or all these different things. And that was part of the challenge each week, to come up with this new and unique approach to whatever the challenge happened to be, so that the person who you have now dressed up to be this role could begin to inhabit it. And yet I think that sometimes we all have places where we have to learn how to put on a mask, learn how to put on a role, and sometimes I think it becomes difficult to separate the role that we're playing from ourselves because we're so used to fitting in, we're so used to being what other people expect us to be, that we don't know how to take the mask off anymore. And the word hypocrite comes originally from the idea of an actor wearing a mask, of being something that they are not. And so when Jesus talks to the Pharisees about being hypocrites, it's as if they're playing a part. It's as if their whole being is wrapped up in this thing, in this part that they have to play. And they've lost who they are and who they were created to be. You know, even though it's relatively recent that we've been able to do a heart transplant, the Bible has talked about it for thousands of years. You know, Jeremiah can talk about God taking this law that was given, this law of how we were supposed to live as the people of God, and having it written on our hearts and everybody understanding and knowing and living out of it. Or in Ezekiel, talking about taking our hard hearts that have grown hard and have protected themselves from the world but are no longer malleable, and taking those out and replacing them with a soft and fleshy heart. And sometimes that's hard. I think the world wants to create us as being hard-hearted, as being people who, again, and it's not that a hard heart is stronger than a soft heart. If anything, what we know of the human body, a hard heart actually breaks. But a hard heart that's no longer able to do what it was created to do, to live out of this way of love, of grace, of peace, of truth, of compassion, to see one's neighbor and to care about one's neighbor. I mean, I think we know the two great commandments. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. Every piece of who you are is to be directed into that, and then you are to love your neighbor as yourself. And yet, it's so easy to close down, to lose the will to do that very thing, to see the pictures that come on us through our TV screens, to hear people take one group of people and say, well, they're less worthy of our respect than this other group of people may be. You know, who is my neighbor? Well, I want to make that boundary closer and closer and closer and closer, so I have to care about less and less and less people. And our heart grows harder and harder and harder. And then there's the other way. The way of the heart transplant. The way of the fleshy, soft heart that God places within us. A way of a heart that has God's written law written upon us, that sees the other person and says, Here is my neighbor, the one who I'm called to love. Here is the one who I'm called to bring in to be a part of my people. You know, as Moses in Deuteronomy is looking out over the people of Israel, as they're getting ready to go into the promised land, a trip that Moses is not going to make with them, his greatest fear is that they will grow hard hearts, that they will lose the will to do the things that God has called them to do, that they will forget what it means to be the people they were called to be, that they will put on the masks that everyone else around them wears, that they will begin to act that part instead of living as a people who other nations look at them and say, what is this? Who are they? What is this that their God has given them? They're living differently. They're doing things differently. You know, the Pharisees and the scribes, whoever these individual religious leaders who are in conflict with Jesus at this point, they see what other people have seen too. So other people have seen that Jesus and his disciples are living differently, and they're drawn to it. And yet, these people, these religious leaders, they see that Jesus is living differently, and they're concerned by it. They begin looking for the little things that they can pick at, you know. So they're not washing their hands right. They're not doing this right. They're not doing this right. You're doing it on the wrong day. You're doing it with the wrong people. And they need a heart transplant. You know, one of the struggles of religion at all times. You know, James is not the only one who's ever seen this. What is it supposed to be? Well, it's to take care of those who need taken care of. It's to show compassion and mercy and grace. And yet it's so easy for it to become, you know, a place where we all put on our masks and our hearts become hardened and we want to all look and act and think and believe exactly the same. And I think there are times where we need to acknowledge that, God, I need you to heal my heart. Heal my heart, O God, so that it may be that which you need it to be. Write your law upon it. Take the hardness out of it and make it soft and fleshy again. Make me able to do the things that you call me to do. Make me able to go where you call me to go. Give me not only the rational thought, but the will and the emotion. You know, you call all of me to love all of you. And perhaps all of me needs that healing. So as you call us to love you with all our heart, with all our soul, all our mind, all our strength, may you heal all those things. Heal myself and heal my neighbor so that we may be the people you call us to be. And perhaps through that you might heal this world in all of its brokenness. Maybe that is a part of what the creation is indeed waiting on. And it's got to begin somewhere. You know, there's the old song, "Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me." Let there be healing on earth, and may it begin with us. Thanks be to God. Amen.
On the days of
As we have witnessed God's word and love this day, we are called to reflect both to the world around us. May you feel Christ's presence in the upcoming week and be surrounded by the comfort that comes with that. Now go in peace and in love.